The views expressed on this episode of the Came to Believe Recovery podcast do not necessarily reflect those of KHLT, Take 12 Recovery Radio, or our affiliates. The opinions on this episode should not be taken as medical, psychological, or professional advice and are those of the host, co-host, and guest. KHLT and Take 12 Recovery Radio are not affiliated with any particular 12-step fellowship. Well, greetings, my friends. I am the Monty Man from Take 12 Recovery Radio, and this is the Came to Believe Recovery Podcast. And now, here are your Came to Believe Recovery podcasting broadcasters to launch us forth on this week's show.
Well, hello, welcome, and welcome back to the Came to Believe Recovery podcast. My name is Alicia, and I am here with my co-host, Tom, and our amazing producer, the Monty Man. Hi, guys.
Hi, Alicia.
Hi, Alicia.
Hi, Tom.
Hi. Are you ready for the Came to Believe icebreaker?
Maybe. I don't know. Let's see.
Come in.
Well, hello, everybody. It's me, Cecil. And it's that time of the show where we ask the question, what does Alicia's shirt say?
Thank you, Cecil.
Well, I'm glad I have a shirt that says something. And it says...
What's it say?
Practice like a star.
Like a superstar.
And act here. So you can act like a superstar or practice like a superstar.
Yeah, so if you're just listening on the audio podcast and you're not on the YouTube version, this is a good reason why you should subscribe to the YouTube channel.
Right.
So you can see what alerts
you. You can see my shirt.
I like that. Practice, act in the middle. Like a superstar.
You need to take action, right? You need to act like the way you want, and you need to practice that.
Yeah.
Because it's not going to just happen in one action.
No.
It's not.
No. It's not. Well, that's good. So what did you do? What have you done this week to practice like a superstar, Alicia? Taking too slow to answer that, huh, Tom?
Yeah, I'm telling you.
You're what?
Taking too slow to answer that.
I know. Well, because my mind went in different directions. I would say trying to do step 10 and be accountable and really chill on wanting to go into old habits with like weight gain and stuff like that. And I'm being more mature.
Yeah.
And practicing the steps and doing what I can do so I can really watch my macros. I got my blood work done.
Yeah. I have
contact to go see a naturopath because I will never see a regular doctor because I don't trust them.
Mm.
And do what I can and talk to my husband honestly about what's going on because
so it sounds like a lot of accountability really works for you, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think it works for most of us. If we'd be honest, we just don't like it.
Right. Mm-hmm. Honesty, that is like my word of the month or the year, is just being completely honest with what I'm feeling and what I'm doing and calling my sponsor every single week, which I've been doing. And yeah, so that's practicing like a superstar.
And of course, Tom, you already are a superstar.
Well, and if you saw me in the gym the last few days, you would know that that's true.
Oh.
We have cleaned our workout. We have upped the game in the gym. I'm shocking the system. and people just stop and look. They don't know what to do when they see it. So,
You don't know what they're thinking. They just think something else. And you think they're looking at you, and they're not looking at you.
I got my food also dialed in. We're dialing in some stuff. I got myself shaking off California, things that went on there. Yeah, practicing, keeping this ball rolling forward on all levels.
Yeah, yeah. Well, good
deal. And I'm loving, actually, let me point out, I'm loving his facial hair. Just got to say.
Oh, yeah.
If you're not on YouTube, you need to check it out. And he needs to keep it. I like it.
It does look good. Yeah.
It does.
Yeah.
Do other people in your life like it or no?
They do.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not. It's
I like
not
it.
Unwanted.
Yeah. Yeah. And no, it looks good. You sport that very well.
You do.
Well, thank you. But I have an icebreaker question, and I would love a report. So you've got to break the glass or do something, whatever you do with the icebreaker.
Let me see if I can find. Well, I got this.
Look at his face. He's waiting.
You didn't hear it, did you?
No.
I heard it like...
Let me see. Oh, I know. Here we go. Sorry.
All right. Monty, this question is for you.
Okay.
Give us the porta potty update.
No.
How is it in the middle of the night going out to the porta potty? Because last week, remember, you hadn't actually had to do it. You hadn't actually had to do it yet. Now you've had to do it.
Yeah. So we gotta for listeners' sake, we're remodeling our bathroom. We only have one bathroom, and so it's like a 3-week project. And so we had to rent a porta potty. My wife said, "Why don't we just get one of those commode things that are portable and just." Put it in the laundry room. We could just use it. I said, I am not pooping in a box inside my laundry room. Then you got to empty it.
Like a cat?
Yeah.
Then where do you dump it?
That's what I said. What, do we dig a hole in the backyard?
Like camping?
No, you seal it up and throw it in the trash. You go, no, you can't do that. No, 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 no.
I wear diapers.
So went and got, yeah, I suppose. I haven't got to the diaper phase yet of my life. I hope I don't for a long time. But, so we rented a porta potty, and it's a double wide, so it's luxurious, right? As luxurious as can be. And it comes with two rolls of one ply, which is useless. And then on the wall, there's like a big old honking thing of hand sanitizer that comes with it. And it's just weird. I mean, you got to lock it up at night because people will camp out in them if you're not careful. But the container that you use, they fill up kind of quick. You know what I mean?
A little quicker than it does in a porta potty.
Yeah. I mean, cause it doesn't go on the ground. It's a container inside the container. And then you got to call them out for $45. They'll come out and service it for you. You know, they put a big old hose down it and suck it all out and clean it up, all nice and everything. But it's just a little creepy. I mean, you know, so at night, like if we have to get up in the middle of the night, Marsha or either one of us, we have to get the key. We got to go unlock it. The lock from the inside is just a little flap.
Right.
Basically tells people on the other side, you know, that it's occupied. But it's kind of unsettling. You know, we live right down the street from the sheriff's office, the parole and probation office, and the county jail, and two homeless shelters and a warming center. And I'm like, yeah, so we have a lot of interesting characters walk through our neighborhood. Just the thought of being in there at 2 or 3 a.m. doing my business with just that little flap to keep the door shut. It's a little unnerving. Yeah.
Do you take a flashlight or does it have a light?
Yeah, well, we have for our stairway in our house, we have one of those little motion sensor thing. It's magnetic, you know, that goes off in the stairway when somebody goes up the stairs. So we just took that, put command strips on the back of it, and stuck it in the porta potty. Mm-hmm. And so we used that. But yeah, it's just
how much longer do you need to use it?
Probably another week.
Oh, that's not too bad.
Yeah.
See, that it would you know, it would move me towards language that I've generally eliminated from my vocabulary. But there's a couple of words that if I opened my eyes at 2 a.m. and I had to go to the bathroom, would immediately want to come out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Get up, get dressed, go outside, unlock the thing. Da-da-da-da.
Oh, I know. Mm-hmm. I know. So this is how I don't feel. I don't feel like that.
But then perception could be switched, right? Which I'm sure you are thinking about too, is like you have the luxury of redoing your bathroom and the means to do it. And
yes,
it, you know,
oh, yes.
And it's going to be beautiful. So we can try to like redirect to that point.
In the middle of the night, you're going, oh, be quiet, Alicia.
I know.
No, but you're right.
But still, right? I mean, you could keep your old bathroom and or kind of get uncomfortable. And
well, we're very grateful because we really thought we were going to run into a lot more black mold than we did. We found a little bit, but hardly any. And which really, because our shower / tub was one of those things, right? So you got to step over it to get in. Had two big holes inside where there was a rod which you would hang a wash rag on. Well, that broke years ago, and those holes remained open. So a lot of moisture got in there until we finally sealed them up with like Gorilla tape. But it was like that for probably 3 or 4 years. And we thought, you know, moisture inside between the wall and the fiberglass, that's not a good thing. We didn't find but maybe 5 inches of mold. Usually you have to follow it and keep ripping out the drywall until it ends, right? Praise God, that did not happen. We did not have, that was our biggest fear. And because in old homes, our home was built in 1945. In old homes, you find that a lot. You're not too sure what's going to happen until you rip out a wall. So we are very grateful for that. And we are very thankful that we have a contractor that he's family. He's excellent. And we think a lot of him. We have a lot of respect for him. And so it's nice to be able to leave your home. While I was at the AA convention last week, we were able to leave the house for a week. No worries, you know. So much more to be grateful for than to whine about. Absolutely.
Yes.
There you go. Any more icebreaker questions there, Tom?
No, that was good. I want to hear about your odyssey.
Yeah. Yeah. So let's take a short break. And when we come back, what's the topic, Alicia?
It is forecasting our own failure and not doing that.
Ooh, forecasting our own failure. Okay. Listeners, don't go away. We'll be right back. Check this out. Hey, this is the Monty Man. Now I know you're already listening to our Came to Believe Recovery podcast, but did you know there is so much more to Came to Believe Recovery? Now I'd like to invite you to experience their website right after this show and get to know the incredible work that you can be a part of as well as we work together to break through to the hope that comes through what the founders of Alcoholics Anonymous referred to as the spirit of the universe. So, write this down. CameToBelieveRecovery.org. You got it? That's CameToBelieveRecovery.org. Now, back to our show.
This is Justin White, and you are listening to the recovery talk and positive music of Take 12 Recovery Radio.
Anybody know what
What television show that music's from?
I think it's from Lost in Space.
You are correct. Wow, you get a bell.
Wow.
Lost in Space.
I don't even know what that is.
the reason that I played it was, you want to talk about somebody who forecasted his own failure. Dr. Zachary Smith. Remember Dr. Smith? Yeah. So Dr. Smith, his job was to sabotage the Jupiter 5 or whatever it was called, this the flying saucer that the Robinsons would fly. And he jumped on board and he stowed away inside the thing. He programmed the robot to destroy the ship. Well, his plans failed, and he ended up lying about his ability to be a doctor, and he ended up being part of the crew. And this guy was Mr. Negative. He was always, you know, oh, it's never going to work. Oh, the pain. Oh, Will Robinson, which was his buddy, little buddy, the youngest of the Robinson family. He kind of attached himself to this kid, and the kid kind of became a victim of Zachary Smith's negativity. And so the child was constantly trying to cheer him up. You know, it's okay, Dr. Smith. It'll work out okay. You know, kind of. Mm-hmm. And Dr. Smith always saw the negative side of everything, always. And I thought, how appropriate, because here's a guy who forecasted his own failure, you know, right from the get-go. And I wonder why you picked this topic, Alicia.
Mm-hmm. I just think it's a wonderful thing to talk about.
Yeah.
And to be aware about forecasting our own failure. Like when we do it, I think we need to be aware. Are we in negative thought mode? And can we redirect it to positivity? And then also when we see it in others, like our sponsees or even family or what, and like, yeah, do we say something or do we not? When is it appropriate to point it out? And then it goes back to that, like, well, are we looking at a speck in someone else's eye when there's a big old plank in my own eye? We need to look at ourselves, but I mean, there's always a plank in our eye. But I wanted to like talk about that too, of not only looking at our own negativity, what about if it's happening around us? Do we just let it go, or do you say something?
Mm. Well, the first talking point you have here, which is great, is problem thinking versus solution thinking. So what are some examples of problem thinking?
It could be, well, it's never going to work. I can't do it. I've always been this way. It's happening again. Woe is me, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
With anything, not even only in recovery stuff, but it could be with a sponsee and just how they're talking and they can't do it. It's always been, I'll never make it. Those big words that we use that are speaking that into our lives, right? They're claiming that identity.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say, well, if you fight for your limitations, you get to keep them. If you say you can't, I believe you. You can't.
Right.
You won't.
Right.
So
it's like you say, I'm always recovering. I'm never mm-hmm. recovered. I believe you.
Mm-hmm.
People that say I'm not actually recovered, they're probably not. So I want to kind of clear something up here, or at least avoid confusion. I don't think we're talking about name it and claim it, blab it and grab it, and prosperity stuff. You know, I can manifest positivity by, you know, I'll think $1,000 over and over and over again, and it'll show up. Because I have a couple friends that say, I need to manifest this. I need to manifest that. And I'm like, yeah, you're creeping me out.
Mm-hmm. You know? Mm-hmm.
But there's some truth about bringing forth stuff, right? Based on what's coming out of our mouth. So even though we're not talking about like a prosperity gospel necessarily. There is truth that if we speak something forth enough. So my wife would tell me, I would say, man, I think I'm coming down with a cold. And she goes, don't claim that. And I'm like, but no, you can't fix what you don't acknowledge. Right? Okay. Yeah. It's okay to say, I think I'm coming down with a cold so I can treat it. Mm-hmm. So is there a fine line here, you guys?
There's a fine line. And I mean, I definitely don't believe the name it and claim it, but think about this. This is what I think. So it's negativity. It's how do we look at things? Is it in a negative atmosphere or environment or positive, right? So we got two, we always have a choice as we're going through life, I think. So on a pouring rainy day and the Yankees aren't going to play and I don't get to go see them and I'm going to miss a picnic and it's going to happen. I have two choices, okay? I can be negative and miserable and whine and cry and have it be raining and have the Yankees miss it and miss my picnic. Or I can be positive, I can be happy, I can be doing some productive things and have it be raining and miss the Yankees and miss the picnic. What's my choice? Mm-hmm. That's where we go into worry and remorse and maybe anxiety. I don't even know if that's anxiety because that's a different thing. Anxiety is stemming, but this choice of whether we go through our lives, generally just everything is negative. And I'm with you though, where, and I'm going around in circles here, that somebody that just, everything's just okay, right? Sometimes you want to say, well, it's not okay.
Yeah.
Right? There is something that's not okay. It's not okay that it's raining. It's not okay that we're going to miss this. It's not okay that this event is happening. It's causing hurt and something. But can we be positive about it? Can we say, okay, yes, these are negative, but I'm going to, this is what I can do. I can't, you know, it's almost a serenity prayer thing. I can't change this, but what I can do is this or that. I mean, should we ever be negative? It's different between acknowledging that something's wrong and something's going and being negative about it or positive. Does that make sense? There's that line. I mean, there's, I don't know if that's a line. It's a attitude.
Yeah. Well, because Monty, you could have been, and maybe you are off screen, just complaining all day long about the porta potty and, oh my gosh, they messed up on this. But eventually you'll have to be like, well, it's not beneficial to anybody.
Right.
You're getting upset and your wife is upset and it's not fun to be around people like that. And then, so it's like, well, let me just appreciate that this is going to be done in a week or, you know, I think it could be as simple as that. But some people are like that all the time about everything. And it's just ridiculous.
So Thessalonians 5:16 through 18 says, rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ. So I think all means all, usually. I think in Greek it means all. I think in Hebrew it means all. Mm-hmm. All means all. So giving thanks, it doesn't necessarily mean, you know, the world teaches happiness. The gospel teaches joy. You know what I mean? Happiness is based on your happenings. And if they match up, good. But joy comes from the Lord, right? It's the joy of the Lord that's my strength. So I can give thanks in something and not be happy about it, mm-hmm. but I can still be thankful. Thankful that we have a porta potty. Thankful that we have the money to rent the silly thing. But why do you guys think we go? I mean, don't you think that our needle tends to lean towards the negative almost naturally? Is it because of our sin nature, maybe?
You will tell somebody a negative thing 10 times more than you will tell them a positive thing.
Why?
We notice the negative. We focus on the negative. We start with the negative of in any situation. Listen, everybody, they always start, if there's 10 positive things and 2 negative things, what's focused on? The 2 negative things.
Sure.
It's like human nature. And you're right. Why? My mother was the most, the perfect at coming in. And if I said, you know what, I think we're going to leave my job, I've got a new job. Well, how are you going to pay your bills? How are you going to do? It was always starting with what was going to be wrong with it before. And never was it, oh my, that sounds like such a wonderful opportunity. Wow, I know you've been looking for something different, and I know you haven't been happy for what you're doing. It sounds like it would be good. And then somewhere down the line say, and you know, I mean, I guess there is a couple of negatives that you could see, right? Nobody does that. My other friend flew the airlines for 20 years with no mistakes. They're the greatest place. They lose his luggage once. They're the worst airline that you've ever seen. Never fly them again and tell everybody to leave. How many times are we ready to cut something out of our lives when it's one mistake? How would we like to be cut out of others' lives every one mistake that we make? Mm-hmm. I have become so much more tolerant with that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And say, it's all right. It's just that you made a mistake today. Yeah, it's not okay, but whatever. It's just a lot of good came out. It all got done. I don't know. Monty, we go negative for some reason.
So one of the things that my wife pointed out to me before, and this is one of the reasons I love her so much, is when she points something out at me that I should consider correcting, she's very gentle. She is never harsh. You know, she makes statements like, you may want to consider, or here's an idea, would you like to hear it? You know, I mean, you know, it's a wonderful relationship, and it's, you know, really due to her. So one of the things that she pointed out to me not long ago was our son would come up with an idea like, hey, Dad, I'm thinking about buying this car. And I immediately go to, okay, well, does this, I mean, you commute to work. Does this car get good gas mileage? Mm-hmm. What kind of mileage does this get? You know, I don't think that particular car gets very good gas mileage, and they're not that dependable. What about the wear and tear on it? I mean, you're commuting and blah, blah, blah. And from my point of view, I'm a concerned dad that's got life experience that I'm trying to share with him. But what Marcia was trying to tell him, it's like I'm immediately, you know, undermining his idea of getting this car.
Yeah. And
what he doesn't want any of that. He's an adult. He doesn't want any of that advice or anything. He just wants me to say, well, cool. Yeah, when can I go for a ride in it? Or something like that, you know?
Right, right.
But my perception is I'm just trying to be helpful.
Well, where's the line? Like we said before, because, I mean, there's people in my life, Tim's family, and the daughter bought a truck and her mom didn't say anything. Mm. And now the daughter is like, I don't want these payments. I don't need a brand new truck. And then, so I think where maybe you say, to your son, do you want my input or do you want me to just cheer you on? But then he'll know you have input. And that's why you said that.
Yeah.
But I think sometimes we would want to say something if we know and have experienced it and you are the dad and you are older. But again, he needs to learn and now he'll learn. Maybe he got the car and now he's like, ugh, it gets terrible gas mileage. I should have listened. Right.
Well, I think he would come to me more often with questions if I wasn't quick to offer them before he asked me for them. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Again, he's an adult. And to say to him, you know, to bring up all these issues, it's almost like saying, well, evidently you don't know to think about this stuff. And it might make him, you know, feel pretty bad about himself. I mean, gosh, my dad doesn't even think that I, you know, because he said to me before one time, he goes, Dad, you know what? You know, I am over 30. It's like, and then I'm like, yeah, I'm just the old guy who doesn't know anything.
Mm-hmm. You were 30 once too.
Mm-hmm.
I like to say that. You know, I was 32 once.
Right. Right.
I think it has something to do with the psychologists would say about making us feel better about ourselves, and we can put something or someone else down. it makes us feel better, or it helps us get excuses for making our bad decisions, or I don't know. Why do we tend to highlight the negative?
Yeah.
I got caught in the rain in New York City the other day, and New York City's the stupidest place in the world. It's rain. There's nowhere to go. There's no, I mean, this is where we go. It's so stupid. I can't believe anyone would live here. People pay more money to live in a place. Watching people on bicycles soaked, just riding with their clothes on, like, this is like Keystone Cops. Who does this? And condemning an entire culture, you know, from rain because I forgot my umbrella. Right? So, we knew it was going to rain. I could have brought umbrellas and raincoats. We should have. We didn't. So we're stuck in the rain. And had I had all that, I don't know that I'd have noticed any of all that. Right?
Yeah.
So
I think it comes down to emotional sobriety again. Mm-hmm. What are the unenforceable rules, demands, and claims am I putting on other people or circumstances or the world in general? You know, you know, if you're a responsible son and you need to listen to my advice, you're not allowed to, right. to not. You're not allowed to not listen to my advice. You know, I can't enforce that. You know, what about, is it selfish and self-centeredness? Is that really the root of our problems in all things, it seems like? I'm being inconvenienced. Poor me.
Yeah, it was. Poor me. Rain right down. Well, see, so in Monty, in your case, I think I've adapted sometimes in those things. A lot of times I'm just quiet. Like Alicia's brother, and I just let the thing go. Because I'm so conscious that my mother would steal the wind out of every balloon I had.
Yeah.
That to go negative, I'm so conscious to never start negative, even if I see some glaring thing that's a problem right off the bat. So you're going to get a new car. And he'll say, yeah, I'm getting a new car. So when are you going to get the car? Oh, I'm getting it so-and-so. Oh, that sounds cool. What kind of car are you getting? And is that car? And just ask questions.
Right.
And it'll lead you to him generally down to a place where they'll either give up the information or
right.
it'll turn to him asking a question. Well, why? Do you think it's not good? Well, you know, because until they ask, they're not listening.
Yeah.
That's anybody.
Sponsees included.
Right. Until they ask.
Which brings me to what Alicia, the question Alicia has, how to navigate pointing this out in other people.
Well, there you go. Mm-hmm.
I think I get the whole idea of watching your own bobber, staying in your own lane, taking the log out of your own eye first. And I think when it comes to specific issues, like if somebody has got a problem with profanity and they've come to you for some help in it and they keep falling into it, until you've started working on your own issue, if you have the same one, then you really don't have any right to point it out to them until you've cleaned up your side. But if you have a problem with profanity, but somebody that you're working with is having a problem in another area, can you point out and suggest where they may be able to improve in that area? Because that's not your problem. Does that make sense? Because I think a lot of times say, well, you know, you got to stay in your own lane all the time. I don't think so. I think because we're not perfect, we're all going to have issues. But if there's something that's harming you and you've given me permission as your accountability base, i.e. sponsor, mentor, then if it's not an issue that I'm refusing to work on and it's totally separate than what I'm dealing with, then I think I do have a responsibility to point it out to you in a loving, kind, compassionate manner without being controlling. Is that even possible? Loving, kind, compassionate, no controlling.
So I'm going to challenge something.
Okay.
I think if you can't be perfect, and then only in the things you're perfect can you call someone else in. I think if you're somebody who has profanity and you maybe don't struggle, but it's something that you are trying to keep control of, in an instant where someone else has an outburst that's inappropriate, I don't think just because you may have an outburst once in a while that's inappropriate that you can't call them on it and in the moment. Because people will say to me, well, you do sometimes. I said, well, I do. And I would say it was not okay for me either in this situation. But gotcha. For me not to say, it's not okay right now. This is where you got to watch this, you know? And I know because I do it. I think you can. I think you can call them out.
Okay.
Well, I was actually going to say the same thing because with my sponsees and I call them out on certain things with food, which I'm still working on. So I think it kind of gives me accountability or gives me credibility that I can recognize it in them because I'm doing the same thing.
And here's the thing we do bringing up this. When someone and someone that I was I was with last week said something to me and I quickly said, but you do this.
You're and deflecting.
You know, you often will always say that. You'll say that, but I do this, but it doesn't. How does that solve that you did this? And they're right. We're talking about a situation in time right now. This thing, I don't get to do my thing because last week they did their thing.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So right. I'm really conscious too now if someone says to me, you know, you did that, not to go right back and say, well, you do that too, or you do this as an excuse.
As if that justifies your behavior.
Yeah. I mean, this is growth to really think, I need to take that. They're telling me it's not a defense, you know, right? That's that whole, you get immediately defensive because you don't want to be not perfect. We don't like it, especially in the eyes of someone that you're close with. Mm-hmm. And if you're posturing, all of a sudden you're now put down, right? Because that's how we are. We're not quite perfect. Well, this is a chance to do well, you're right. I'm sorry about that. You're right. I did do that. I apologize. I won't do that again. And what I said after saying it back was, you know, you're right. I do that sometimes. And if I do it, it's not on purpose. And I will make I really will work on that, not going back, because what you said was correct. And it's not right for me to throw that at you. We're really good at this stuff, guys, but not every, I mean, this is how the world, this is how we're supposed to do this, right? If, on a good day.
So you guys, there's a philosophy that says you should only correct somebody if they've given you permission to do so. And I get that, but see what you guys think. As people who are brothers and particularly people that are brothers and sisters in our faith, simply because we are members of that family, don't we have the responsibility to call things out even if the person didn't give us permission?
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
Not saying that I do it, but I fully believe that's biblical. That we are, and they say it's not judging. It could be, but we can see things that people are doing that are harming them, and that doesn't mean that I'm not doing the same thing or the things that are harming me, but I think it goes both ways. I need to be okay with them pointing it out to me, and they need to be okay with me pointing it out to them.
Isn't there the scripture that says we hold each other up, we correct our brother when he's
if you're standing in front of a train and you're about to get hit, it's probably not wise for me to say, well, I can't pull you out of the way. I got to go get your sponsor. Hey, Mr. Conductor, slow the train down. I got to go find their sponsor because they gave him permission to correct them. I don't have it, so I can't push you out of the way. I agree. I think.
I mean,
do you guys have any examples of where you actually did that? Because
called out a total stranger.
Or somebody that you were a little uncomfortable to say something. I don't think I've ever done that.
I did one time with, I actually followed the example of somebody actually did this, and then I had the opportunity to do it. So, and this goes back to the profanity thing. I had a very good friend who had an amazing story to share as far as their recovery goes. But, they injected a lot of the F word. And so I told them, I said, and I wasn't their sponsor or anything, just a friend. I said, you know, you have a really, really good message, but it gets lost with all the profanity in it.
Mm. How did they take that?
They took it really well. They were like, I wasn't even aware I was doing that, you know. So I think it's all in the approach, right? On how you approach it.
Yeah.
You know, you say, you know what? I started out liking your share tonight, but, you know, you just really turned me off with, you know, all the cussing. That's not going to go over the same way. That's almost like an attack. You know what I mean?
I've adopted the next day rule on some things where I'll approach somebody the next day after something.
Yeah.
When it can be approached from as little of the emotional side as possible. Sometimes I'll sit down. Okay. You know, we need to talk about something. And I want to talk about what happened yesterday. Mm-hmm. And can we sit down for a minute and just talk about it? And then you've got this person not in the heat of whatever it is.
Sure.
So I try, and that's been very effective for me. Partly, too, because I'm not all upset. And I've thought about it and prayed about it and said, should I even say? Because, you know, right? There's sometimes you say, you know what? It's me. Is it me or is it them or who? Mm-hmm. But Alicia, I would tend to not say anything because I don't want to hurt someone. You know, I'm a little bit of people pleasing, approval seeking. And I was raised, my mother raised and father raised us to be quiet and don't cause trouble. And I battle with that. So a perfect stranger doing something or someone, I would tend, except for life threatening and something egregious, I would tend to not say anything. Mm-hmm. I reach people hurting people in the gym every day. And I should go up and say, stop, you're hurting that person. That's absolutely wrong.
That's a whole other avenue. Well, what about when I see people eating toxic poison all day long, every day, and I just sit there?
No, you don't. Remember this?
Yeah, but is that okay? Is that not okay?
For me, it was beneficial. I mean, I was like, I need that, but not everybody's going to respond that way.
No, they're not.
So what's our responsibility? It's true. It's also whether they're going to hear it or not. I mean, the you know, you throw the seed on the bad ground. Do you throw it on the bad ground? Or do you throw it on ground where it'll be fertile? Right? I mean, I don't know whether we judge. I don't know. That's a tough one. Now, what about this, though? We haven't touched this part of this conversation where we predict our failure. This is this different element of it that I'm not going to try this because I've never been good at it and I don't have any ability to do this. And I've never, it's too hard. And I don't see my way through it. Every time I've ever tried, I've failed. Those kind of things. I can't bench press my body weight because I've never been able to. Can you do a push-up? Or, you know, none of the yets. So let's talk about that for a minute. Where we, what do we call?
The word usage.
Yeah, we just, I can't think of the word.
Set ourselves up for failure. We're forecasting our own failure.
Sabotage ourselves with our own work.
So do you think, it has been said by somebody that I have a lot of respect for that the best predictor of future behavior is relevant past behavior. Now, my wife disagrees with that because people change. So in the area of people changing, I would agree with her. But I think that is usually pretty true. And I think maybe that's where we get this, I can't, I always, I never, because something's happened that validates that. We've either witnessed it and think it's too hard or difficult or too challenging, or we've tried or attempted to do something and we gave up really early and just accepted our fate, so to speak. So my future behavior is based on my past behavior of looking at those things as too difficult because of something I experienced. What do you think about that?
Yeah, well, I think it's combined with stories that we tell ourselves, and many of those stories are false. And I've taught many times of, I don't know what step, maybe 6 and 7, where I'm saying predictability. You're taking your past and you're putting it in your future and your present. That's a choice. I've always been like that. I'm going to be like that now. Well, you're choosing that because you don't have to do that again. You can stop right now.
Is that because we really don't want to try?
Well, that depends on the thing, I think, too. And our beliefs lead to our actions. So if I believe wholeheartedly that I cannot do this thing or I don't want to do this thing, I'm not going to do it. And so I think it's here. Our thoughts lead us to what we're doing. Like if I like in my situation of not being very happy with what my body's doing, I could be like, you know, whatever, which I did do for a while. But now I'm like, I'm going to get through this. I'm going to figure it out. And I will. And either be okay with this, or I'm going to do everything that I can in my power and then adjust and pivot to whatever it is.
So the unknown will lead you to not do it.
Oh, that's true.
Unless you have curiosity and say, I'm going to figure this out.
What? So this is how we work on step 10. Well, we didn't think we could quit drinking either. And we never think we could do, but look at what you did. So if you could do that, now what else might you be able to do?
Right.
When I got sober, there was a whole, I wouldn't have thought of going back to college. It was all those things. I can't do it. I have no, it's that ship has sailed. I mean, I wouldn't know how to start. I haven't been in school in so long. This is the unknown. I don't know what it's going to be. I'm just talking like this past behavior that was, that maybe intellectually, if you take, it's the dilemma that we talk about, right? We know one road, we know that road, and that road won't work, the road we were on. This other road that somebody says, we have no experience with that road. So we tend to not want to try it. Why would you? Without a power, without some hope, without some level of discipline, which I'll show you that definition in a minute. But when I was taught about short-term goals and long-term goals and said, well, you're thinking about going back to school. Well, why don't you see if you can get your transcripts? Because how can this happen? All right, just get your transcripts. See if you can get them. So I got them. All right, now do this. Now do that. And one step at a time, things started to happen and it started to move forward. And they started to think, well, a lot of other people, if you got to look around, a lot of other people that don't seem as bright as me, and I don't want that to sound arrogant, they're doing it. Why do I just think I can't do it?
Yeah.
And what if I fail? What's the harm in doing? Anyway, I went and started school and started having success after success. And then Monty and Alicia, what that taught me was, the next time I think I can't do it and I could never do it, well, I thought about that for this one too. And look what happened. So now I start with, I can't do it yet. I haven't decided to do the work to do that right now. But I try not to say I can never do that. It's not possible. But it came from these experiences of little wins. When you start to get the little wins and you put them back and say, well, I used to think that way about that too, but then I got over that. So maybe I can get over this. And I think it really does back a growth mindset from a fixed mindset. I'm going to try. Let me give it a shot. Let me give it a, what do I have to lose kind of thing.
Yeah.
It's what you get, I think, if you work 10, 11, and 12. If you're in the recovery world, and you keep looking at right side living and you keep seeking the will of God, when you're confronted with questions and when you're confronted with these things, I think you get positive, you get answers, you get direction, you get the ability to take a step some way and then evaluate it the next day. Well, that step worked. So, wow, next time I'm afraid, let me take that step, or that step didn't work. Next time I won't take it when I think that's the right thing to do, the green light, red light thing. But going through this process of kind of changing my mindset, giving myself a process to go through. Until I had that, I would always go negative, right? Until I knew, wait a minute, I do have a way of kind of evaluating this whole thing. But I didn't have that until I had hit this place where I had to do it to stay alive. I don't know. Does any of this make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think it comes down to honesty and what your motives are and what you really want and the power of our thoughts. Because you can talk yourself into something and you can talk yourself out of it. It's your choice. Either I'm not going to go back to school for XYZ reasons, or I am. And now what? Okay, I am. So what do I have to do? Do it. Same with anything. Like, I'm going to do 10 every day. I'm going to learn. I'm going to read the Bible. I'm going to grow in my faith in step 11. Do it. I mean, it could be this big. It could be this big. Or you say, no, I'm not doing it. And then we're over here. No,
but wait, here's one, too, though. I like what you're saying, though, Alicia. It just because you don't do it doesn't mean you're fear. So let's say someone else in my life wants to speak Spanish. We got to go learn Spanish. Could I learn Spanish?
Yeah, but do you want to?
Oh, right. But I did it, and it's not a choice because I can't do it or it's going to be too hard. Because, see, that's the bad part, if that's where it's coming from. It's coming from I've evaluated what learning Spanish in my life would be, and we do have choices, and whether I feel like using my free time and my time that I have to be productive or learn something to do Spanish. And I decided no. And so I'm comfortable with it. And it's not a cop out. Does that make sense?
Yes.
I'm not going to learn Spanish. I don't want to.
I think Alicia said, you know, she mentioned choice. What's your motivation? And see, I think that's it. I think, you know, things start with our desire. What's my desire? You know, what is the desire of my heart? Forget about whether I'm able to do it or not.
Yeah, right,
I'm not there yet. What's my desire? What do you want to do? I had a boss ask me one time when it came to a promotion. I could have gone this way or that. They were both promotions. And the committee's all sitting there, and I'm sitting there just being quiet, and they're all talking about what they wanted me to do. Half the room wanted me to do this, the other half. And my boss looked at me and said, wait a minute, everybody. What's Monty want to do? Monty, what do you want to do? Mm. And I said, I want to go this way. This direction. I want to work in this area. Well, then that's what we'll do. You know, and so I think it's I think it starts with desire. What is your desire? And if I can try and talk myself into doing something. If I really don't want to do it, I'm probably going to talk myself right out of it. You know what I mean? So I don't think it's wrong to not desire to speak Spanish. If you really don't want to, but if you really do want to, stop saying it's too hard. Stop saying I can't. Stop saying, because if you really desire it, you're on a good, you're starting out well. So don't throw a wrench in it when you're starting out well, you know? And so one of the things I used to tell the guys at Teen Challenge when they'd say, well, I'm trying. I've tried so hard and I just can't. Usually can't follows that the try word.
Right.
And so you're starting out with two negatives right away. I said, okay, put your hand down on the table. Everybody's got their hand down on the table. I say, okay, on the count of three, I want you to try and lift your hand up. One, two, three. Everybody's hand will go up. I go, no, you're not listening to me. Put your hand back on the table. It's count of three. Try and lift your hand up. Same thing. I say, okay, I want you to listen to me really close. All right. One, two, three. Now, try and lift your hand up. And half the room would get it and they wouldn't lift their hand up. I said, there, you got it. You either do or you don't. There's no try. Mm-hmm. Once you enter that realm of try, you will fail. Once you enter the realm of do, you will succeed. It really is as simple as that. So if I've tried and tried and tried and tried and I can't, I believe you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Always, never. Like you've got here. I said something one time and Tom corrected me and it really, and I've never said it since. We were talking about I think funding for Take 12 Recovery Radio. And I said, you know, and I was saying it in a positive way, but it really hasn't had a negative to it. I said, all the stuff that we've got, all the equipment, all the microphones, the studio and everything, you know, personally, I don't have anything. This was all gifted to us by donations. And Tom said, stop saying you don't have anything. Remember that, Tom?
Yeah.
And I realized, wow. No. It doesn't matter where it came from. The fact is, I'm one of the wealthiest guys I know. Mm-hmm. Maybe not by the world standards, but I got my own porta potty, man. And it's a double wide. How many people in my neighborhood have a double wide porta potty? Nobody.
I definitely don't have one yet.
Yet, right?
Porta potty. And I mean, that makes I like that sense where I would say, if I wanted to speak Spanish, I would not say it's too hard. And I'm not saying that now. I'm saying I don't want to speak Spanish. I don't want to learn to speak Spanish. Is it too hard? I don't know that. No, I don't think it would be. If I would, I'd work at it. They have all these things. I have experience being successful at stuff like that. Mm-hmm. If I want to spend my time, but I'm not going to spend my time doing that. I'm not doing it.
It might be hard.
Yeah.
It might be hard. That might be a practical thing to realize. But if you say it's too hard, then it's not going to work.
Also, let's talk about that, because Alicia and I talk about that. Is it hard or does it take effort? And there's two different things. When you say something is painful and it's so hard, really, why don't you say, it's making me uncomfortable and it takes a lot of effort.
And I'm pressing through.
I'm pressing through. Yeah, I have to use some effort. But is it hard? I don't know. Hard is so negative.
And it's relative.
Right. And it's, there's effort.
For you, it may be. For me, it might not be. So
yeah, I have to put up
for now. It's not fair for me to say to you, though, oh, listen, man, you know what? I've done this. It's not that difficult. And I'm minimizing your experience. That can be a little mean, right?
That could be a little mean.
Yeah, but
if I said to you, it took some effort. Yeah. Yeah, it took some effort and some discipline, and I had to, focus, and I had to delegate time toward it. And yeah, there was some uncomfortable, but it's possible. It was possible for me, but yeah, there's effort. It's better than, it was hard. It was not good. I'm just saying that those words are so, I'd much rather have someone say, I'm going to be uncomfortable and it takes effort.
Yeah, but there's people that don't want to be uncomfortable ever. And they don't want to be disciplined.
Uncomfortable is what changes them, right? And
but look at our world. Yeah, Nobody wants to do crap ever ever.
Right.
They don't want to work. They don't want to go to the gym. They don't want to eat right. They just want to do nothing. And
And
complain about all the consequences that they're living because
And then they get mad at us for pointing it out, and then it's.
So let me give kudos. I want to give kudos right now to anybody that is in a residential treatment center or intensive outpatient. I don't care if you've been court ordered. I don't care if you're there and you walked in the door of your own free will. I don't care if mom and dad gave you an ultimatum. It doesn't matter. You are there right now. Right now, you are there. Maybe it's Teen Challenge. Maybe it's Salvation Army. Maybe it's Victory Outreach. Who knows? But you are there. And you are clean and you are sober, and it may have been only 24 hours, but you know what? Congratulations. You have put one foot into a journey that is going to take you to success. It is going to take effort. It is going to be a challenge, but it's going to be an opportunity. Don't shortchange yourself by saying, I've tried this before and I just can't do it. It's going to be the same old thing. You don't know that. You're not a fortune teller. So I just want to say congratulations to anybody who's listening that has got 24 hours clean and sober. I don't care how you got it. You're not the same person you were yesterday. You're just not. And I mean, I used to tell my guys that all the time when I was teaching 12-step workshops out at Teen Challenge. I'd say, you are not the same people you were the day you walked in here. And we need to start speaking that into people's lives, that even if they put one toe across the threshold of success, congratulations.
You never have to do that again.
You never have to do that again. You never have to be alone again. You are on a road that is leading you to victory, and you're victorious today. So I get excited about stuff like that. I get excited when we celebrate people's accomplishments in their sobriety. I get excited about that. And it's just a beautiful thing. Yes, we are living in a world that is strangely pathetic in so many ways. But what a glorious, glorious life it is, regardless of all the
muck.
All that stuff, right? It really is. Guys, we're out of time. Alicia, closing thoughts.
Stop arguing for your limitations, people, because then you get to keep them. Knock it off. And many times, most of the times, the obstacle in the way is you. And you need to stop. Mm.
Tom, closing thoughts?
Get some accountability people around you. Get some people that'll call you on your stuff. Embrace uncomfortable. Understand that there's a little effort. Whistle while you work. You got to go to work anyway, guys. So why don't you whistle while you're doing it? You're going to be at work all day long doing your job. You can be whistling or not.
Yeah.
It's time to change your attitude. If you're in a 12-step fellowship like ours and you're not being taught how to live on 10, 11, and 12, which will teach you how to turn that attitude around and be right side living, come to one of our retreats. You'll learn what I say and learn to get that power in your life and learn towards positivity. Go from victory to victory, guys. And let's say yet, I can't do it yet. I haven't done it yet. Mm-hmm. It's got to be at the end of all those sentences. Just give it a shot, guys, and you will be amazed before you're halfway through how much positivity in your life.
Amen. So our closing song is one that was very popular a couple years ago within the recovery community. It is still appropriate today. It is by Matthew West, and it's all about identity. Am I an alcoholic? Yeah, it's simply a medical term that means I'm allergic to alcohol. I am not defined by it. And Matthew West gets that. Here's his song, Hello, My Name Is.
Hello, my name is Regret. I'm pretty sure we have met. Every single day of your life, I'm the whisper inside that won't let you forget. Hello, my name is Defeat. I know you recognize me. Just when you think you can win, I'll drag you right back down again till you've lost all.
I've been saved, I've been changed, I have been saved.
is a powerful song. Listen, though it is true that it is impossible to fix a problem that we refuse to acknowledge, where do we go once we have recognized that problem and have admitted our need for a solution? Well, for those of us traveling the road in recovery, we turn to the 12 steps for direction and spiritual guidance, which eventually points us to God. As we learn how to apply and implement these spiritual principles, we will learn that we can and do recover from our maladies. And once we have experienced the spiritual awakening as the result of these marvelous steps, we learn that we are no longer defined by what used to describe our lives, the life we have left in the rearview mirror. Yes, it is true that I am an alcoholic, but this is a title I used to avoid because it did define me as what society deemed a loser. And don't you know, we tend to believe those negative voices much of the time. But what these steps have taught me is that my alcoholism is simply a medical term that recognizes that my body does not process alcohol in a way that most people process it. My pancreas doesn't respond to alcohol in any other way except that of a horrible toxin, and my brain doesn't either. Therefore, I see my alcoholism as nothing more than an allergy of the body. As far as the obsession to drink, when I'm stone cold sober, well, God has removed that obsession many years ago, and no longer do I live in bondage over it. Well, once we have experienced a state of recovered, we are defined by the power that now flows in and through us, the Spirit of the universe, the Spirit of the living God. Our lives are no longer defined by our character defects or even our allergies, but by the grace and mercy of a loving God. So, what is your forecast for the future? Is it failure? Is it shame? If so, may I introduce you to the God who removes these labels and gives us a new heart, a new mind, and a new forecast. His name is Jesus, and he is looking forward to hearing from you. It's simple, really. Just talk to him like you would talk to a trusted friend. Listen, if it is true that God created us in his image and spoke the world into existence, then it just stands to reason that we, to some degree, can speak our world into existence as well. Now, I'm not suggesting that we can manifest money or the perfect relationship just by speaking positive affirmations all day long. But our words do have influence in whether we forecast a positive or negative outlook on life. So let me ask you again, what will be your forecast for today, tomorrow, and the weeks to come? It's something to think about. Came to Believe Recovery strives to create and promote opportunities for life-changing spiritual experiences for individuals and families suffering from all forms of addiction. For more information, help, and support, visit cametobelieverecovery.org. I'd like to thank you for allowing me to be your host on this episode of the Came to Believe Recovery podcast. And I would encourage you to like, bookmark, and subscribe to this show. When you do, you will join the Take 12 Recovery Radio family and will be notified of all of our recovery-focused shows throughout the week. Until our next broadcast, when we provide the essential spiritual tools needed to thrive by sharing our experience, our strength, and our hope through our stories of how we came to believe.
This has been a production of Take 12 Recovery Radio.
Woo, kitty, kitty, kitty. Meow.
Woof, woof.
This has been a Chicken and a Pig production.